map's going to show that in spherical polar coordinates, LZ has a very nice simple form to it. So in spherical polar coordinates, using the fact that by the chain rule, the partial with respect to phi is equal to the following combination. So, in other words, if I want to differentiate some function with respect to phi, well, if I were to change variables from Cartesian to spherical coordinates, then the chain rule in multi-dimensions says that d d phi would be partial with respect to x times the partial of x with respect to phi, plus partial with respect to y, plus the partial of y with respect to phi, plus partial with respect to z, times the partial of z with respect to phi. So that's just the chain rule in multi-dimensions. You have one term for every variable, as opposed to the one-dimensional version, which would be, you know, like ddu is equal to ddx dx du, like you normally do with changing variables or using the chain rule. Here we've got the multi-dimensional version. You're almost happy with the multi-dimensional.
It should be the same. Yeah, it should be the same with ddx times dx du.
What's that? Yeah, so, well, in other words, what I'm saying is that if I have some function, then d psi dv is equal to, so you could certainly write d psi dx dx dv, but I'm writing it in this order because this is, I want to write this as an operator, and in operators it's important, you know, to, the order is important. And so I don't want to imply that I would be taking d dx of d psi of psi dx d phi. So if I want to write this as an operator, I have to put it in this order, because order is important with operators. So this guy's lying in wait for some coordinates and function to walk by, and then he's going to take it and differentiate with respect to phi. Using that, we can show that L sub z has a nice simple form. It's just minus I h bar partial with respect to phi in the position basis. Because we can write down what dx d phi is. Dx d phi is dd phi of, well, the conversion to spherical coordinates from spherical coordinates to Cartesian coordinates is x is equal, you may recall, to r times the sine of theta times the cosine of phi. X is r sine theta cos phi. So when I take dd phi of r sine theta cos phi, I get minus r sine theta sine phi. But what is r sine theta sine phi when we go between Cartesian and spherical coordinates? What was r sine theta sine phi? That's just y. X is r sine theta cos phi. Y is r sine theta sine phi. That's from that picture we drew the other day. So this is just minus y. So dx d phi is just minus y. Dy d phi says take d d phi of left. One of my different differentiating with respect to phi. See if you're following along here. R sine theta sine phi, yeah. Well, that's gonna, if I take dd phi of sine phi, I get cos phi. So I'm gonna get r sine theta cos phi. What's r sine theta cos phi? X. So dx d phi is minus y, and dy d phi is equal to x, and dz d phi is equal to d d phi of what is z in polar coordinates?
Cosine.
R cos theta. So what is d d phi of r cos theta? Zero. Yeah, that's equal to zero. So minus IH bar dd phi is equal to minus IH bar y ddx from the first term, because dx d phi is minus y. Minus y ddx, stop me if I say something wrong, minus y ddx plus x ddy, or did I pull a sign there? Let's see. Is that okay?
Right.
Yep, okay. So therefore, so minus ih bar dd phi then is going to be IH bar y ddx minus IH bar x ddy which I'm supposed to be claiming is LZ, so now I have to remind myself that that's really LZ from the earlier notes. Otherwise I'm embarrassed trying to figure out how to move the sign. So LZ is minus IH bar x ddy minus y ddx. So that seems okay. Yeah. Or we said that LZ was minus IH bar x ddy minus y ddx is what we've written before. So happiness and joy. So that checks out. LZ is just minus IH bar dd phi. That's the z component of the angular momentum operator in spherical coordinates. So even though spherical coordinates often make things look more complicated in terms of the operators, here's a case where it makes it simple. We've only got one differentiation to worry about. Notice it's differentiating with respect to the azimuthal angle to get the z component of the angular. And this isn't really right, but you can sort of think of it in other words as well. Where do you get z angular momentum? From orbiting in the xy plane. So it kind of makes sense that it's the azimuthal variable that is telling you something about the z component of the angular momentum. Yes?
What's that
term? So if I want, if I have something orbiting in the xy plane, what direction is its angular momentum vector? It's up, right, along the z-axis or along the minus z-axis, depending on whether you're rotating clockwise or counterclockwise in the xy plane, as seen from above. So I'm saying, even though this isn't rigorously correct, I'm saying it's plausible that it's a differentiation with respect to the azimuthal variable, changes in the phi that are related to the z component of the angular momentum in quantum mechanics. That's very hand-wavy. But in other words, because classically motion azimuthally is what's related to the z component of the angular momentum. That's what I'm saying. So it kind of makes sense that quantum mechanically it's changes with respect to phi in the xy plane, kind of, so to speak. Well, or things parallel to the xy plane that produces z angular momentum. And again, that was kind guess the argument, but it's just kind of a, you know, a way of remembering it, sort of. Okay. Well, that's nice, because it means it's pretty easy to find the eigenfunctions of that operator. Because notice that as an operator, it looks just like we had for the ordinary momentum operator, which was minus I h bar ddx. We already know what eigenfunctions of that look like. They're e to the ikx type of things. So we're going to do the same thing here.
The eigenvalue problem of LZ.
So for now, we're going to denote the eigenvalue by L sub z, and then later we're going to find out it's an integer, which we're going to call m. So we'll call the eigencat a cat with a label L sub z in it. I can't help myself, apparently. Yep, I'm going to get me my own eigen. So then what we're saying is the LZ operator applied to the eigencat gives LZ times the eigencat. Again, I emphasize the thing inside the cat is just a label. It's just saying this is the cat with eigenvalue L sub z, or a cat with eigenvalue L sub z. We haven't normalized it yet. And so if I apply LZ to it, out comes the eigenvalue. In the coordinate or position basis, then our representation in terms of a wave function would be, we'll call it psi L sub z of r, well, actually of just theta and phi, because only the angular variables are involved here. So it's some function of theta and phi that we want to be an eigenfunction of the L sub z operator. And so in that basis, because the operator is represented by minus I h bar d d phi, then what we want to solve is minus I h bar d psi L sub z d phi is equal to L sub z times psi L sub z of theta and phi. That's our differential equation that we're trying to solve here. LZ operator applied to psi sub LZ is equal to LZ times psi sub LZ. Is because we did this separation of variables, we split the wave function into a radial piece times an angular piece. And the angular momentum problem only comes from the angular piece. And so therefore, it would actually be okay to multiply this by some function of r. It wouldn't change anything. But we're thinking of that as being factored out into a separate term. Any other questions? We're about to find out this one doesn't even depend on theta, but for now we're saying, well, maybe it has theta in it. But look at the differential equation here. Solution is that I sub L Z should be what? Give me a function where minus I H bar times its phi derivative is L Z times the function itself. I L Z e to the I L Z not just over H bar, because if I take the derivative of that with respect to phi, I get zero. E to the I L sub Z phi over H bar would do the trick. So some A times E to the I L sub Z phi over H bar will do the trick. A can, in general, be some f of theta, because the theta, as far as the differentiation with respect to phi is concerned, f of theta looks like a constant to that. And let the theta part belong to the rest of the angular weight function. So in other words, what we're eventually going to do is write that the YLM is PLM of cosine theta e to the IM phi, kind of jumping ahead. So suffice it to say, we're just going to let A be a constant and let the theta dependence elsewhere in another function that's going to be multiplied by this, the associated Legendre function. So constant e to the ILZ phi over H bar is in fact an eigenfunction of L sub Z. It looks just like we had for momentum in one dimension, where we had minus IH bar d psi dx is equal to p psi. We did that, and then we said, okay, then psi was equal to A e to the I p x over H bar. Here we're doing the same thing, except that instead of p, we've got L sub z in the wave function there, and instead of x, we've got phi over here. Other than that, it's exactly the same mathematically. Okay? Happy? Not happy? Any questions? So if I take the derivative of this with respect to phi, I get ILZ over H bar times it. Then I take minus IH bar times ILZ over H bar, and I get LZ. So far, is there any restriction on the values of L sub Z? No, none whatsoever. It works for any L sub Z.
So in other words, we have a continuous variable.
Except that we don't. But so far, it would look like we do. Because we would like the wave function to be single value. See, the difference between x and phi is that phi is a cyclic coordinate. If you add 2 pi to phi, you're back where you started again, right? So if we want the wave function to be single value, we want the wave function to also be back where it started again when we go 2 pi around or 4 pi around or whatever. We, being the picky people that we are, demand that the wave function be single valued. we want it to be true. That if we jump up to the full beast here, that psi, that psi LZ of phi plus 2 pi ought to equal psi LZ of phi. But if I add 2 pi, I haven't changed anything. So that says e to the I LZ phi plus 2 pi over h bar should equal e to the I LZ phi over h bar. I just add 2 pi to phi and say that shouldn't change what I get when I just put in phi. So that says e to the I 2 pi L sub z over h bar should be equal to what? 1. Yeah, because this factors into e to the I LZ phi over h bar, e to the I 2 pi LZ over h bar. That should equal 1. And for what values of theta is e to the I theta equal to 1? Well, 0 works. What else works? 2 pi works. What else works? 2 pi, 4 pi, 6 pi, minus 2 pi, minus 4 pi, minus 6 pi.
A lot of pi.
4, 2. Yeah, so it says that theta is equal to 2m pi, m an integer, for all those values, e to the I theta is equal to 1. So this says that LZ, because we've got 2 pi LZ over h bar has to equal 1 here, this says that LZ has to be equal to m times h bar. So if that's m times h bar, then 2 pi LZ over h bar is equal to 2m theta. 2m pi, that's what I meant to say. So demanding that the wave function be single valued puts a restriction on L sub z. It has to be m h bar, where m is an integer, basically. 0 plus minus 1 plus minus 2 is just long-winded for m is an integer. We've done the same thing over here, 0 plus 1 plus minus 2. So that says we can also say that we can say that the wave function is labeled with psi sub m instead of L sub z. Psi sub m of phi is some normalization constant, which we're not going to worry about because we're going to throw it in. We're going to normalize the whole angular wave function later. Some constant times e to the I m phi. Very simple, e to the I m phi. So the angular part of the wave function, the azimuthal dependence of the wave function, this is very simple basically for eigenfunctions of LZ. It's just e to the I m phi, e to the I m phi, however you want to say, phi. You're done. Question? Or not? Yes?
Yeah, it's trivial. Is it phi or phi?
Yes, it is phi or phi. I believe that, well, I think it should be phi, is what it comes down to. Because I think, if somebody who's taken Greek or whatever, correct me if I'm wrong here, but I think that the Greeks would pronounce it as phi. But as happens with many things, we in English-speaking countries often decide to make I's out of E's. So we'll say phi instead of C and phi and so forth. We'll say psi and phi and so forth. Actually, I don't know if PSI might be psi, but I'm not sure. But in any case, I think it's actually phi, but people say both phi and phi. So in other words, I can say phi, phi, fo, fum. And it's spelled like that. Phi, phi, fo, fum. I smell the blood of an English monk, which sort of rhymes, but doesn't go to bed. You don't know about that? Jack and the Beanstalk. Giant says, fee, fi, fo, fum, I smell the blood of an English mun, and then he's gonna like eat Jack or what is it? Something's up, grind his bones to make my bread or something like that. Yeah. Yeah. I missed out on this great literature.
All the American chapters.
Yeah, I'm sure there's some good Vietnamese stories, you know, that you'd be like, what? Right? So. Okay. Now, so far so good, we got the z component of the angular momentum. We know the possible values for the z component of the angular momentum. It's integers times h bar. You've seen that before when we talked about hydrogen wave functions in 280. We talked about the psi-LMs, the wave functions where they're psi-NLMs. They're characterized by the principal quantum number n, the orbital angular momentum quantum number l, and the z component of the orbital angular momentum quantum number m. And this is that m that shows up there. That's the m in psi sub nlm for hydrogen wave functions. Now let's worry about that other part, the l part, where we said. And so let's make the separation constant, obviously, L times L plus 1. Well, now let's say why we made the separation constant L times L plus 1, which seems strange at first. How will we do that? We will talk about now the eigenvalue problem of L squared and LZ also. We've already solved it for LZ, but we'll see how it's related to L squared. Something really clever again, namely we're going to define raising and lowering operators and do everything algebraically, kind of like we did with the harmonic oscillator. So, L squared, which is L dot L, which is Lx squared plus Ly squared plus Lz squared is the square of the total angular momentum operator plus Lz squared would be the total angular momentum. Quantum mechanically, as an operator, the sum of the squares of the three component operators is the operator which represents the total angular momentum squared. And that's what I mean by the L squared here. The operator which represents the total angular momentum squared of a particle we have that. If I look at the commutator of L squared with Lz, that's going to be equal to then the commutator of Lx squared with Lz plus the commutator of Ly squared with Lz plus plus the commutator of LZ squared with LZ. One of those I can simplify right away. Which one? The last one, right? Because any operator commutes with any other operator, which is just some function of it alone. So LZ certainly commutes with LZ squared. And I mean, you know, if you don't believe that just from what I said, well, that commutator is going to be LZ squared LZ minus LZ LZ squared. And that is going to be LZ cubed minus LZ cubed, which will be zero. So that goes away right away, and we only have to worry about the first two pieces. Now, if you were insane, you could apply the test function. But if you're not insane, you would use our fun commutator identities. How can I simplify this sucker right there? What do I do? Pull an LX out to the front, and then pull an LX out to the back. Yeah. So this turns into LX times the commutator of LX with LZ. But aha, we wrote down what the commutation relations between the various LX, LY, LZ was. Remember, we had commutator LX and LY is IH bar LZ. We'll throw that in momentarily. So then plus LX, LZ, LX. So we pull LX to the back and to the front, like that. And similarly for the other one, so we've got plus LY commutator of LY with LZ plus commutator of LY with LZ times LY. Now, the commutator of LX with LZ is equal to minus IH bar LY from those commutation relations we had before. Because remember, we started with LX LY is IH bar LZ. That's the one we proved, and we said, and it's not hard to show that it works cyclically. So if everybody takes a step, either all jump to the left, except the guy on the end jumps over to the right, or vice versa, it's still valid. So in other words, I can do something like this. I could pull LZ over here, but then LX has to move to the right to make room, equals IH bar, and now LY moves over to take LZ's place. So the commutator of LZ with LX is IH bar LY. But we have here the commutator of LX and LZ, and if you flip the order in a commutator, you change the sign. Because the commutator of A with B is AB minus BA. The commutator of B with A is BA minus AB, which is the opposite sign from AB minus BA. So if I change the order here, I get that LZLX commutes to minus IH bar LY instead of plus IH bar LY there. So I get to go nuts replacing LXLZs with minus IH bar LYs. So this turns into minus IH bar. Order is important, so I have to say LXLY here, and then on this term I have minus IH bar. Here I've got LY times LX. And then in these terms, if I commute LY with LZ, if I start back with the original one, the one you just, you know, just remember this when you get all the other ones, LX commutes with LY to IH bar LZ. Well, here I've got LY LZ. If I have everybody step to the left, so LY comes over here, bumps LX to the end of the line, and then LZ comes over here to take the place of LY, that says that LYLZ is plus IH bar LX. So I'm going to use plus IH bar LX in those commutators. So this turns into plus IH bar LY LX plus IH bar LX LY. And then I say, oh, glory be and hallelujah, because here I've got cancellation, right? In other words, here I've got LXLY times minus IH bar and LXLY times plus IH bar. They cancel. And here I've got minus IH bar LY LX, and here I've got plus IH bar LY LX. It all worked out to zero. Woohoo! Which I suspect is easier than using a test function, but at the very least it's more elegant than using a test function. So in other words, LZ and L squared commute with each other. LZ and L squared commute with each other. Conclusion. Simultaneous eigenfunctions. They have a complete set of simultaneous eigenfunctions. Now that's true for LX and LY too. L squared commutes with LX, L squared commutes with LY. So, and that's got to be true, because is there anything special about the z-axis compared to the x-axis and the y-axis? Well, no. It's up to us what we call x, y, and z-axis. So it has to be true that this is so. And in fact, in general, it has to be true that the angular momentum component operator along any direction commutes with L squared. Z is a direction, therefore, you know, that's one of them, right? But this has to be a completely general relation. So you shouldn't be under the impression that, you know, LZ is special in that regard. The more general statement is that you can find simultaneous eigenfunctions of L squared and the angular momentum operator along any direction that you like. So you pick a direction and anoint it the direction that you like, and then you can write a complete set of eigenfunctions of L squared and that operator. And we usually pick Z to name, but Z is really, in other words, in this sense, Z is just the name of the direction that we have so anointed to be the one that we're going to use to write down a complete set of eigenfunctions. What are the, if I'd use the x-axis instead, what would the eigenfunctions look like compared to those for LZ being the special axis? Well, the answer is, you would take the ones that you got with LZ and just rotate them around so that they pointed along LX instead, not along X instead. If you want the ones along the Y direction, well, you take the ones along the Z direction and just rotate them 90 degrees so that they're pointing along the Y axis, so to speak, instead. No matter what direction in space you pick, the eigenfunctions look exactly the same, the ones that are simultaneous with that in L squared. They look exactly the same as the ones that we build for the z-axis. You just rotate them around to point in some other direction, is what it comes down to, so to speak. So there's nothing special about L sub z other than we like the letter z, is really what it comes down to. It's just, we're just making that the name of the axis that we're picking, and then we're making our spherical coordinates based on that axis. There's nothing stopping you from calling the x-axis the polar axis, or whatever. Okay? Simultaneous eigenkets. other words, L squared applied to alpha beta is going to be alpha times alpha beta. So in other words, alpha is the eigenvalue of L squared. Again, alpha beta is not a product. I'm not multiplying numbers together. It's just a label. If it helps you, put a comma between the alpha and the beta. Because what we're doing, yeah, we could, but what we're going to do here is if we made it L squared, we're going to have this, we're going to find this relation for alpha that it's more convenient not to have it being squared everywhere. That's what it comes down to. So bear with me. Trust me, this is better. And LZ applied to alpha beta is going to give beta times alpha beta. So beta is the eigenvalue of L sub Z involved. Now let me jump ahead to where we're going to get, just so that you can say, oh yeah, good. We are going to show that for orbital angular momentum, and I'm adding orbital angular momentum to that because we're actually going to discover that spin could exist out of all this too. We're going to discover that angular momentum can be integer or half integer. And so we're going to have this hint that, oh, there could be some other kind of angular momentum besides orbital angular momentum. We're going to show that for orbital angular momentum, that we'll find that L squared is actually going to equal L plus 1 h bar squared, the eigenvalue, you know, is alpha. I should say alpha, because we're calling that the eigenvalue of L squared. We're going to show that alpha is L plus 1 h bar squared. L being some non-negative integer. And that beta is equal to m times h bar, where minus L, I'll write it where it's easier to say. M ranges from minus L to L in steps of 1. In other words, we're going to show what you've already seen before, only before you've just been told it. If you heard it in 280, you might have been shown it in PCAM. But in 280, we said, you know, we had waving chicken feet. Well, here, I'm going to take the chicken feet and throw them in the trash. We don't have to wave them anymore. We'll show that, in fact, this is what comes out of all of this. But the remarkable thing is that it comes from the commutation relations. Knowing these commutation relations implies all of that. You don't have to solve any differential equations or anything like that. What's fundamental about angular momentum is the commutation relations that the operators obey. And all of this comes out of the commutation relations, which is kind of remarkable. Okay, any questions? Take me out here. Is this going to be great or what? Yeah. Right here. So, what are we going to do? We are going to define the lowering operator. Simpler than we would. plus an A minus, because remember they had this like 1 over the square root of 2 m omega h bar in their definitions. None of that here, it's just lx minus ily. Another thing is, it's a plus that has the minus in front of p, and it's a minus that has the plus in front of p. Here, l minus has a minus, and l plus has a plus. Well, thank you for that, I appreciate that. L plus, so we define the raising lowering operator, and the raising operator. L plus is Lx plus Ily. What would possess us to do such a thing? Well, it's going to be that if I apply L minus to an eigenket, it lowers the z component of the angular momentum by h bar. And if I apply L plus to it, it raises the z component of the angular momentum by h bar. So in other words, it increases or decreases m by 1. So it's going to be similar to what a plus and a minus do. They increase or decrease n for the quantum harmonic oscillator by 1. These suckers increase or decrease m.